You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Today is the second anniversary of the Waco Massacre. And I don't want anyone out there to forget it, ever. 1,000 years from now, I want patriots somewhere, and I mean patriots to principles and ideals of liberty and freedom, to remember the Waco Massacre. Unfortunately, it appears that someone is using this anniversary to promote an agenda, and we will be discussing that. But for right now, there's a vote coming up on the Conference of States in Minnesota. So this is important. The Council of States resolution has passed in the Minnesota House. We must stop it in the Senate. Hearings are scheduled for tomorrow, Thursday the 20th, at 8 a.m. in room 15 at the Capitol. Now, whether or not you intend to testify, please show up to express your opposition. If you don't think you have time, you can't take a day off work, then think again, folks. What price are you willing to pay for freedom? Please make your calls and or fax the message to each senator. Tell them that you oppose the Conference of States and that you would consider it their patriotic duty to vote against it. These are their numbers. All numbers begin with 612-296. Again, all of these numbers begin with 612-296. Senator Berg, 5094. Once again, it's 612-296. All of them begin with those numbers. Senator Berg is 5094. Senator Berglund, 4261. That's 4261. Senator Bertman. Senator Bertman, 2084. That's 2084. Schmielewski, that's Senator Schmielewski, 4182. And don't worry if you can't pronounce the name. Call anyone. 4182. Senator Flynn, 4274. That's 4274. Douglas Johnson, 8881. That's 8881. Senator Lessard, 4136. That's 4136. Senator Marty, 5645. That's 5645. Senator Merriam, 4154. That's 4154. Senator Metzen, 4370. 4370. Senator Moe, 2577. Senator Moe, 2577. Senator Novak, 4334. That's 4334. Senator Piper, 9248. 78-09-248. Senator Pogemiller, 78-09. That's 7809. Senator Reichgott, 2889. That's 2889. Senator Salon, 4188. That's 4188. Senator Speer, 4191. That's 4191. Senator Stump, 8660. That's 8660. Senator Vickerman, 5650. That's 5650. The fax number for all of these people, all you have to do is put down their name and send the fax to this number, is 612-296-6511. That's 612-296-6511. Remember, this is for the state of Minnesota. Ladies and gentlemen, Minnesota is going to vote on the Conference of States resolution. It's passed through the House. Hearings are scheduled for tomorrow morning, Thursday the 20th, at 8 a.m. in room 15 at the Capitol. Be there. Oppose it. Whether you're going to be there or not, call all of these senators and fax and oppose this. And make sure, ladies and gentlemen, that you do this. It is important. And now, this morning, just after most of the workers had entered the federal office building in Oklahoma City and prepared for their daily routine, an explosion occurred. No one was prepared for this, ladies and gentlemen, least of all those inside the building who found themselves suddenly falling, tumbling through the air. Many of them were buried beneath tons of debris. As usual, the intelligence service has all of the facts that are available at this time, and you will find these facts have not been reported in their entirety anywhere else in the world, including the major media in the United States, including even the media in Oklahoma City. As usual, we have our people on scene with press passes in hand, and they have given us a preliminary report, which I will now relay to you. It is important that you listen carefully, ladies and gentlemen, because rumors, as always, abound. And we have heard every rumor and every possible solution to this. What you are going to get now are the facts. Then we will discuss some of the reports, erroneous and otherwise. There is an agenda here. And if you will remember, I told you that this would happen. I said it on this broadcast that the incidents of terrorism within the United States will escalate to the point undreamed of by the American people. What is the agenda? Well, you're going to find out. Our station chief was in Oklahoma City all day. Most of the facts that are available have been scantily reported on the local news in Oklahoma City only. The national news reports, especially on ABC, are completely off base and out of line. As you might expect, the body count keeps going up, but as far as actual on-the-scenes reporting goes, at 4:30 p.m. this afternoon, Oklahoma time, only 22 confirmed dead, 17 of them children, from the daycare center. Washington was reporting 81 dead, but no one on the scene can confirm any numbers yet that even approach that number. The number confirmed at 4:30 p.m. was 22 dead, 17 of them children. The Washington, D.C. figure may have more to do with government workers who cannot be reached by phone. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, only 30% of the federal building has been searched because of the danger of the rest of the building collapsing. And search and rescue has been hampered by some intermittent but heavy rain. Temperatures have been falling rapidly in the Oklahoma City area. There are certainly enough people still missing to easily exceed the Washington death estimate, but at this time, their numbers cannot be considered as fact. There are parts of the building which seem held together only by the grace of God. You can look right through the building in several places. As our station chief drove through the Oklahoma City area, she saw glass damage from the explosive concussion as far away as Northwest 23rd Street, which is approximately 2 miles north of the federal building, and as far west as Pennsylvania Avenue, which is about 3 miles west. Her brother-in-law heard the explosion in his office in Edmond, about 15 miles north of Oklahoma City. Her sister-in-law is at this hour still on duty at Children's Hospital, where she works as a nurse. She has been on duty since 7 a.m. this morning and expects to have to continue working throughout the night as more of the injured are brought in all the time. Immediately after the explosion, ladies and gentlemen, the shopping mall at Northwest 50th and Penn was evacuated because it houses a smaller office of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. No mention was made of sealing off any areas in Norman, which is 17 miles south of Oklahoma City. In particular, the office of the FBI, which is located about 4 blocks from the front door of one of our operatives. Tinker Air Force Base was put on emergency alert, and for several hours, no one was admitted on or off the base. Later in the day, base personnel were allowed onto the base, but everyone entering was subjected to a total identification check, and some were searched. The entire Oklahoma Capitol complex was evacuated about 2 hours after the explosion so that the building could be swept for explosives. Army personnel and drug-sniffing dogs were brought in from Fort Sill to search out anything that could be found in the Capitol complex and upon the bomb scene. There have been no further local reports about that investigation since about 4 p.m. Mayor Ron Norick has stated that there were approximately 590 federal employees in the building on the job when the bomb exploded. And there may have been an additional 200 to 400 citizens conducting business in the building at that time. So there could have been, ladies and gentlemen, somewhere around 1,000 people in that building. The total figure at this moment is unknown. The total number of persons reported admitted to area hospitals because of this incident at approximately 4:30 p.m. this afternoon, Oklahoma City time, were just under 300. Many persons are believed still buried in the rubble, and few living that have been rescued were suffering from crush injuries, lacerations from flying glass, and other injuries associated with explosions. One woman buried in the parking garage had to have her leg amputated before she could be removed. According to Dr. Cornelison, who made the report, she would not have lived had the amputation not been performed. There have been many such spur-of-the-moment street corner surgeries performed while rescue vehicles made their way to the scene to remove the injured and the dead. Reports have been heard on radio of 200 adult-sized body bags being brought to the scene in anticipation of the number of bodies yet to be recovered from the building. And unless a tent has been recently erected on the side of the street, the bodies are still being held in a semi-truck, which is serving as a temporary morgue. Huge floodlights have been brought in by an oil field equipment company, and large heaters are also being provided to the scene as rescue work continues into the cold of the night. Police and firefighters on the scanner report that they have heard no other moans or cries for help from any of the already searched area for the last 2 hours. No one can begin to estimate what the situation may be in the remaining 60% of the building. Only a few hours ago, firefighters began working on the second story of the building, searching for anyone or anything. There are 9 stories total, which must be sifted carefully. And the work, ladies and gentlemen, is painstakingly slow because of the dangerous condition of the remaining structure. A lot of heroics have manifested on the part of the rescue workers. A special investigative team from Phoenix has arrived to assist in the search for survivors, and it is reported that they have special sound equipment which can detect the tiny sounds of breathing beneath rubble and debris. They are at work now. All roads leading into the main downtown area have been closed off and are being guarded by police and National Guard troops. FEMA is conducting a practice exercise. They have seized the moment, and the Federal Communications Commission is going through their routine of clearing the frequencies for the use of the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Our station chief drove south on Walker from Northwest 23rd Street trying to get closer, but was turned aside by guarded roadblocks. She tried entering the area from several different possible back roads routes, but there were simply too many police, National Guard, Highway Patrol, and sheriff's deputies to get anywhere near the scene, despite the fact that she possesses a valid press pass and credentials representing the Kaji News Service and Veritas newspaper. Every little alleyway and gravel half road that she tried to access was fully guarded and sealed. The perimeter is solid. And I can assure you, if there was a way to get on the scene, our people would have done it. And in fact, one has, but until that person comes out again, we cannot get a report. For there is no communications out of the area unless you have access to the emergency communications equipment of the officials on the scene. Representatives from Oklahoma Natural Gas were allowed through the roadblocks to get to their damaged building because they are in the process of cutting off all gas lines leading into the downtown area until the total damage can be assessed. All customer calls have been routed to the Tulsa office. The only other people being allowed through the roadblocks are medical personnel who can flash medical cards. No one else is being allowed into the area, regardless of the reason. No members of the local press who were not on the scene within the first hour have been allowed in since the rumor spread of a second and then a third possible bomb. These rumors are not true. And at that time, everyone in the downtown area who did not have a medical, fire, or police function was moved back away from the federal building area, a distance of 5 blocks. There was a media center for the press set up at 7th and Harvey, which is within walking distance of the location of the press conference, which was held earlier today. Because of the general chaos, ladies and gentlemen, no information of any real substance is coming out of this area. Earlier reports were made of 3 possible suspects in a blue pickup truck with tinted windows, 2 of Middle Eastern appearance between the age of 25 and 35, and a 3rd male, no description given, who supposedly was driving this pickup truck. Nothing was said about why they were suspects. But I question this, and so do our agents on the scene, for there is a large population of Middle Eastern Muslims in Oklahoma City, Edmond and Norman, and the University of Oklahoma has several large Islamic student community groups. Unless the 3 men actually did something suspicious, there should have been nothing out of the ordinary about their presence. Many such individuals live and work in this area, especially in that part of downtown Oklahoma City, which houses so many offices for Middle Eastern businesses. These are some of the rumors and erroneous reports and guesses and speculations that have been broadcast around the world today. Now remember, these are rumors, speculations. A local television station in Oklahoma City received a call from an unidentified male reportedly speaking with a foreign accent who stated that the Nation of Islam claimed responsibility for the bombing. On another broadcast, Dave McCurdy, former Democratic congressman, promptly came on television and repeated the same unsubstantiated rumor. An hour later, an alleged official from the Nation of Islam telephoned KTOK radio from Chicago to deny any responsibility for the bombing. On one station, an explosives expert being interviewed stated that all neo-Nazi groups, right-wing extremist political organizations, and fundamentalist religious groups would naturally be suspect because of their supposed hatred of the government. And early on, a political science professor from OCU suggested that the bombing might be the result of disgruntled tax protesters. A second explosives expert, ladies and gentlemen, was interviewed, who stated that the type of bomb that might have been used, since no one knows at this time, was not of the sort that a small local group could assemble, and that it was more likely that the bombing was the work of an organization with much funding and international ties. He suggested that investigators check to see what major drug trials might be going on at this time, and noted that there were similarities between the federal building bombing here and that of the World Trade Center 2 years ago. He also remarked about the fact that the courthouse building is located right behind the federal building, but nothing further was said about that. And I have to say, ladies and gentlemen, that if this second explosives expert is right, he has pinned the Central Intelligence Agency. Another report from the scene stated that firefighters going through the rubble of the federal building discovered other explosive devices and plastic, which had been allegedly kept in the offices of the ATF located in the federal building. That's the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. That particular report, unlike all of the others heard today, was never reported again. We've also not heard it mentioned further on the scanner. It was either another untrue rumor, or if it was true, was quickly squashed. A later radio report made mention of a rocket launcher being found in the debris, which was supposed to have also been in the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms office. That report also has never been repeated, substantiated, or denied. The Hour of the Time is brought to you, ladies and gentlemen, by Swiss America Trading. We suggest that if you want protection of your assets against what is sure to come, and this is just a taste, those of you who have been listening to this broadcast for a long period of time, you know, many of you have already prepared. As prediction after prediction comes true right on schedule, not because I'm psychic, not because God talks to me, not because I look into a crystal ball, not because I'm in contact with extraterrestrial beings or channel the ascended masters, but because I've studied for the last 25 years. It is obvious to anyone who wants to look what is happening, who is bringing it about, and where it is headed. The incidents of terrorism will escalate. The power of the police state will escalate exponentially. Freedoms, liberty will disappear. All nations and all people will be disarmed. There are Russian agents in this country now supervising the disarmament of the United States of America, and we have people in Russia supervising, supposedly, their disarmament also. The Open Skies Treaty allows the overflight of Russian or any other nation who is signatory to the treaty with their aircraft using the most sophisticated of intelligence gathering equipment. the best optics that you can imagine to identify, pinpoint, and supervise the reduction of armed forces and the disarming of the military and the people of all nations. As this happens, we will continue to escalate into a state of anarchy and chaos. Ordo ab chao. Out of chaos will come order, as the people eventually get down on their knees and beg for protection and control. And they will get it. They will get it in spades, and they will regret it forever. A one-world totalitarian socialist government is coming. As this state of chaos takes form, I'll say this again so that there is no misunderstanding. As this state of chaos develops, as local anarchy takes form, food will disappear from the supermarket shelves. The economy will collapse. Those who have not prepared are going to find themselves in a ditch. Now, these are harsh warnings, but they are real, true warnings, and they come from my heart, from a position of knowledge. This is not conjecture. This is what is planned for America. Patriots who are determined not to give up their liberty will fight. Those who will not take sides, either with the New World Order or with patriots in this country, will be the flotsam and jetsam upon the tides of war, and will be at the mercy of the victor. One gold or silver coin could save your life. No one during that period of time will accept paper money under any circumstances. If you do not have something useful or real money to trade on a black market, you will be helpless. You will be hungry, and you will be without shelter. I suggest you call 1-800-289-2646. And I suggest you watch my predictions . And I hate the fact that they are coming true. But I have studied for so many years that I know how this will proceed and how it will come about. The incidents of terrorism in the United States will escalate beyond your capacity to understand it. You heard it here a long time ago. If you read my book, you read it in my book. If you attended my lectures, you heard me tell you in my lectures, every prediction I have ever made but one has come true. Everything that I wrote about in my book, that at the time nothing had materialized and people called me crazy, have now come to pass. The only time I have been wrong on predicting a future event was when I said that Manuel Noriega would not be found guilty in a court of law or serve any time in prison because under the rule of international sovereignty of nations, without a declaration of war, we had no authority to go down there and take the head of another sovereign nation and bring him here and try him in a court. For under international law, they have immunity. So do all diplomats. You're going to see that disappear also. The sovereignty of nations is no more, including the sovereignty of the United States of America. The military forces, the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines are functioning as the police force of the United Nations under Publication 7277 of the State Department's plan for the unification of the armed forces of what used to be called the Soviet Union under the United Nations to function as the only armed force left in the world to maintain peace and order and to ensure the disarmament of all nations and all peoples. This is not conjecture, it's documented in the law. It is a fact. And you have had your head buried in the sand for too long. And what happened today in Oklahoma City was a part of the agenda to bring about the New World Order. You watch as the stories continue to unfold. It is no accident that this occurred on the second anniversary of the Waco Massacre, as you shall soon see, without any input from me. It will become plain. Just keep your eye on the lips of Janet Reno. At 3 p.m. Oklahoma City time, the statement was made on radio that the only persons who might plant a bomb beside a daycare center, which was located in the second floor of the federal building, would be people who had lost children themselves because of the government's actions, and thus we should all suspect survivors of the Branch Davidians. This was immediately poo-pooed by the KTOK news anchor, who may have more sense than anyone previously thought. But this will surface again, I assure you. A later report tied Bob Ricks into the situation because of his involvement in the Waco Massacre. His office is in Oklahoma City. When questioned at the 5 p.m. press conference about the possibility of a link between the Branch Davidians and today's bombing, Ricks said merely that nothing is being ruled out and nobody knows anything yet. Very noncommittal as he shifted uncomfortably from side to side. Intelligence service members have recorded some very interesting conversations from the scanner. One such conversation was being held with a nurse on the scene who was speaking on a cordless phone. She was telling a friend of her experience on the bomb scene and mentioned that as she assisted a policeman with the removal of one of the victims from the rubble, he said, quote, "We're going to go to war over this," end quote. The majority of rescue workers are completely stressed out at this time. Tempers are short, and all patience has been exhausted. They are liable to say anything. You can hear it in every voice on the scanner. Most emergency personnel who have been interviewed on radio and television seem completely shocked, and it is evident that they were totally unprepared for the sheer scope of the carnage and devastation. The first Christian church near the scene has been turned into a counseling center for people on the scene who are too upset to function, as well as for family members of the injured and the dead. The church has staffed the building with psychologists, psychiatrists, and anyone with any counseling training to deal with the people who are in extreme emotional shock. And ladies and gentlemen, I have to tell you, there are so many such people. A call went out over the radio this afternoon asking for more trained counselors and medical personnel to come and help. The post office building has been turned into a temporary hospital. Several triage centers have also been established in several nearby streets. Don't expect to get any mail from Oklahoma City on time. Many local restaurateurs, in coordination with the Feed the Children organization, are providing food for the emergency personnel at the scene, and indeed for anyone who comes along who needs it. The Red Cross has been taking blood donations all day long, and it put out statewide calls for donors of type O blood. The Blood Institute on North Lincoln Boulevard is still taking donors at this time, and the wait after arrival is now about an hour. People are parked wherever they can on the grass, the sidewalks, along the streets where traffic normally flows, desperately searching for friends and loved ones. Our station chief has been monitoring the search and rescue situation all day in her car. And as soon as her husband got home, he began audio taping off the scanner while simultaneously videotaping from the television set. And around 5:30 p.m., our Washington people began meeting with the governor in the governor's mansion, supposedly to get coordinated with the federal investigators sent in by Waco, Reno. And the governor has announced that the entire investigation is now in the hands of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Should we cheer? The last time anyone's lives were in the hands of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, they were burnt crisp. And the ATF wore T-shirts hailing their Texas barbecue. So forgive me if I'm not thrilled that the investigation is now in the hands of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. The most accurate information comes off the scanner, and we are taping constantly all around the area. There is no transmission being made that escapes our agents. The FBI and the BATF have now set up an operational headquarters at 11 Northeast 6th Street. At 7 p.m. Oklahoma time, a call over the scanner reported packages discovered at the Medallion Hotel, and a request was made for a bomb dog to be taken to the hotel, but a search of the phone directory shows that there is no such hotel listed in the Oklahoma City phone book. If anything transpires on that, we will, of course, let you know. Things are constantly continuing to happen. There's a tremendous amount of danger connected to that building, and no one really knows what is holding the rest of it up. When they tell you that half of the building was blown away, that is not quite the truth. Half the building was indeed blown away, ladies and gentlemen. But the only thing that remains is a shell of the other half, for the entire inside of the building was gutted. We have people on scene, and we have people in every aspect of public service reporting to us constantly. As you have heard tonight, this is the only complete and factual report that has occurred through any media all day long. And that is due to the people who have dedicated their resources and their lives and have taken an oath as officers and men and women of the intelligence service of the Second Continental Army of the Republic. Thank them. What happened in Oklahoma City only too conveniently overshadows Waco 2 years ago. Memorize that sound, ladies and gentlemen. You will hear it more and more in America. Not because I want it, and believe me, I have nothing whatsoever to do with it. It is a part of the agenda of the emerging one-world totalitarian socialist state. It is furthering the agenda of the disarmament of the American people, and indeed the peoples and the nations of the world. It is a deceit. It is a lie. It is a manipulation. Hezbollah has no truck with April the 19th. No patriot in this country would ever attack our government without being attacked by this government first. That I can assure you. No fundamentalist religious organization has any reason to bomb any building in Oklahoma City. We all know in our hearts why this was done and whose agenda it furthers. We must never, ever in our lives, or in our children's lives, or in our grandchildren's lives, or their children and grandchildren's lives, forget what happened in Waco, Texas on April the 19th, 1993. I urge you to phone this number and tell them that their scam doesn't work. We remember Waco, and we will hold them accountable. And eventually, the real perpetrators of this crime that occurred in Oklahoma City will be found, and we will also hold them accountable. The number is 1-800-546-3222. 1-800-524. 1-800-546-3224. It is the number of the Justice Department. 1-800-546-3224. 1-800-546-3224. 1-800-546-3224. We remember Waco. We will hold the perpetrators responsible, ultimately, under the law. The fax number is 202-616-9898. 202-616-9898. 202-616-9898. Insist upon a complete investigation of the Waco Massacre. Insist upon a thorough and complete investigation of the bombing of the federal building in Oklahoma City, and insist upon an independent criminal investigation that does not involve the Federal Bureau of Investigation or the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms. The numbers are 1-800-546-3224. 1-800-546-3224. 202-616-9898. 202-616-9898. Remember that sound. You will hear it again in America, and again and again, until they realize their goal of their utopian, totalitarian, socialist world government. What is happening furthers an agenda. It is not our agenda. It is the agenda, ladies and gentlemen, of world totalitarian socialism. And don't you ever, in your wildest dreams, forget it. It will come again. Good night, and God bless you all.
Everybody rolls with the dice are loaded. Everybody rolls with the fingers crossed. Everybody Everybody knows that the war is over. Everybody knows that the good guy's lost. Everybody knows that the fight is fixed. The poor stay poor and the rich get rich. That's how it goes. Everybody knows the boat is sinking. Everybody knows that the captain lied. Everybody shot his broken demon. But the mama or the dogs just died. Everybody's hands are in their pockets. Everybody wants a box of chocolates and a long bamboo. Everybody knows. Everybody knows.
Only on the hour of the time. Before the World Trade Center was blown up, I predicted that New York City would be the target of a terrorist attack. When the attack occurred, I told you on this broadcast that fundamentalist Islamic extremists would be blamed for the bombing and that it would be proven that they had ties, direct ties, to the Central Intelligence Agency. And I was right on every count. And I'm right on every account tonight. We will continue to cover this and bring you the facts, ladies and gentlemen, facts that you will not hear anywhere else.
So many people you have to meet, have to close. And everybody knows. Everybody knows.
Light out for the purpose of your finance. You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. A little nervous tonight, folks. I have a live audience standing here looking directly in my left ear. Louisiana. HCR 13, the Conference of the States resolution, was soundly defeated in the Louisiana House of Representatives today by a vote of 59 to 27. 19 were absent, not voting. But don't celebrate yet, because there is still a Conference of the States resolution in the Louisiana Senate, which is SCR 28. And it's pending in the Committee on Senate and Governmental Affairs. This will be the next battleground, and we will be watching and writing and phoning and faxing in order to crush this measure once and for all. For information, call Fred, area code 504-748-8354. That's 504-748-8354. That's one of those double whammo states where they introduce one in both houses so that if one gets defeated, they still have a chance on the other one. So don't let your guard down and don't let this slip through. If you do, shame, shame, shame on you. And I hate to tell you this, ladies and gentlemen, because I just can't stand being right when I'm right about these things. A pipe bomb located under a wheelchair access ramp exploded around 2:15 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time at the Provincial Legislature Building in Charlottetown, Prince Edward Island, Canada. The legislature was in session. The bomb blew out the windows on three floors. The glass came in on the legislators. One person sitting on a bench outside the building was injured. No suspects have been found. Security has been beefed up. I told you this will escalate. And I'm not joking, ladies and gentlemen. This is not funny. They will do anything. The end justifies the means, is their philosophy. If you read my book, you know what I'm talking about. You know what they're prepared to do. Anything. Anything and everything to get their utopian world government, so that there will be peace forever. They're the best liars who have ever lived. Liars, deceivers, manipulators. They don't want peace, they want control. Total and complete control. Power. Wealth. They want it all. And if we're not careful, they're going to get it all. Have you been listening to the bullshit on television and all across the radio and all the call-ins from the sheeple of the world about this bombing in Oklahoma City? It is disgusting. It's more than disgusting. It is indicative of the intellectual vacuum between the ears of the sheeple of the world. Wait till you find out what's going on in Oklahoma City. You'll get a better picture of the truth. Unfortunately, it is a shame. You wonder how this could work? Well, just listen. Listen to the television. Listen to the radio talk shows. Listen to the hosts. Listen to the people that call in, and then call me back. By then, you should know that it's going to work just absolutely perfectly. ex-Congressperson David McCurdy was on the phone from one of the local stations in Oklahoma City within 2 or 3 hours of the blast yesterday. Some of his comments were to the effect that there's a large Islamic population and many Islamic groups in Oklahoma City, and that they have had speakers from the Middle East, some supposedly belonging to Islamic Jihad and Hezbollah. He made statements that it is a good possibility one of these groups or another Islamic group is at fault, and of the large number of Islamic students and people in the United States. And this all led up to a pitch. Guess what, folks? Remember what we talked about some time ago? This just lying in Congress, waiting to be passed. Remember every time a piece of gun legislation was coming up in Congress, somebody would walk into a McDonald's somewhere and blow away a whole bunch of people? I wrote about that in my book. I said it would happen. I told you it was going to happen. I told you who these people would be. And I told you that this was going to happen too. And unfortunately, I'm right. You see, the omnibus counterterrorism bill is sitting in Congress and has all kinds of opposition up until now. Watch it. Watch it be put on a freight train and pass through Congress, and the president will sign it before you can blink your eyes. The omnibus counterterrorism bill. It and other similar bills, which will implement a heavier, tighter police state, so that the government can protect us from terrorists. And in that counterterrorism bill, it gives the President of the United States, old Willie Clinton, all around him, dead bodies are lying. What's the count now? Way up in the 30s, I think. Linda Thompson can tell you. She's keeping an exact count. Gives him the ability to name any group he wishes as a terrorist group. There is no appeal. There is no nothing. Anyone he wants to name as a terrorist group, he could name. You better not let it pass, but I'm telling you right now, after that bombing yesterday, there's nothing you can do to stop it. It will pass. I don't care if the whole country got up and screamed to stop it. It will pass. I'm telling you now, it will pass. I'm also telling you to do everything you can to stop it, but I'm telling you, you won't be able to. But don't sit back and not do anything. Please. Please. Do it. On the news, they made mention that in addition to the National Guard, they also had Air Force personnel from Tinker Air Force Base acting as perimeter guards around the federal building. This, as you know, is in violation of posse comitatus. But they don't care. And neither do the people in Oklahoma City. Oklahoma City, whether you know it or not, is under complete martial law. Complete martial law. There are tens of thousands, not just a few hundred, not just a thousand or two, tens of thousands of military, National Guard, police officers from every part of the country. FEMA has taken over. There are armored personnel carriers. There are military vehicles, generators, military trucks all over the place. Why? Why? You can't tell me, can you? Because the building blew up? Some people are dead? That's unfortunate. We all hate that. But why have tens of thousands of military personnel, police officers, prison guards, reservists, National Guard, and Air Force personnel taken over the entire city of Oklahoma City? Could this be some kind of drill? I don't know the answer to that, but I know that what is happening is way beyond what is called for. They even mentioned that local and state authorities were manning an outer perimeter and the National Guard and Air Force were manning the inner perimeter. A very good way to keep everybody real far away from finding out anything that maybe they shouldn't. It was also mentioned that the FBI had collected film or tape from several surveillance cameras mounted in parking lots of other surrounding buildings. The telephone company was specifically mentioned. These will be checked to see if they can spot the bomb vehicle and possibly any suspects. The question is, if they do, will the FBI tell the public? Will the public be able to examine these tapes and films? We'll see. And on the scanners yesterday, ladies and gentlemen, very clearly it was stated on the scanners by the officials on the scene that they had found a second bomb. A second bomb. Everyone in the area, even remotely near that building, was told that they had found a second explosive device and were evacuated far away. The press was evacuated far away. No one was allowed near after that time. Now, if this was a hoax and there really was not a second explosive device, why did they call in the bomb truck, which proceeded to the scene? The second explosive device was discussed on the scanners back and forth between the law enforcement personnel, BATF, and others. Eventually, after several hours, it was clearly stated on the scanner that the second device had been disarmed, and incredibly, and in a fearful voice, the law enforcement officer who was speaking said that it was a military bomb. Nothing was mentioned about it after that point. The public was told that there was no second explosive device, and it was never mentioned again. What is the truth? Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know. I don't know. But this is beginning to stink even worse than it did when it began. There was a telephone interview with an architectural engineer who had worked on building the federal building. He said that the bomb was placed in an area which would cause the most damage. His opinion was that whoever was responsible probably had access to the drawings of the building's construction and knowledge of building engineering. Today, they are saying that the bomb was a fertilizer bomb soaked in fuel oil. Now, I have experience with that kind of thing, ladies and gentlemen. When I was a diver, we used ammonium nitrate and potassium nitrate soaked in diesel fuel as an explosive on occasion because it's a slow-burning explosive and it's easy to control. It can also be coated with grease and taken underwater. We don't have to worry about the explosives getting wet and not working. Nor did we have to worry about manufacturing some kind of waterproof device to house the explosives in, which would have directed its force in some direction that we did not want it to go. So I know about fertilizer soaked in diesel fuel is what we use. You could use any kind of fuel oil. And so do a lot of other people. In the military, it's known as a field expedient explosive. It is not a first choice by any means. It's slow burning. If you stack several bags of fertilizer soaked in fuel oil or diesel fuel together with the paper between them. Sometimes one or two or more of the bags will not even detonate. I can tell you from looking at the damage of that building and the great crater in front of the building that that was not made with a fertilizer soaked in diesel fuel bomb. In fact, it's impossible. Whatever did that damage was a fast-burning, high explosive of the type used only in military weapons. And I have extensive experience with that kind of explosive from my time in Vietnam. Any explosive expert can tell you this, ladies and gentlemen, and they'll tell you that I have just told you right on the truth. And from the extent of the damage on one side of where the crater is, which apparently was a bomb in a car or some kind of vehicle parked outside the building, and the lack of damage on the other side, it appears to me that there were two bombs, and I cannot prove this right now, but just looking and assessing from my own personal experience, working with explosives as a diver, and from my experience with explosives and military weapons in Vietnam, it appears to me that there were two explosives, one in a vehicle parked outside the building and one inside the building. And from the way the damage appears to have been set up on that building, the second explosive would have had to been on the lower floors or underneath the first floor. Now that's my assessment based upon experience. It is not fact, and you should not treat it as fact. But I will tell you something that is fact. A fertilizer explosive soaked in fuel oil could not have done the damage to the building that was done, nor would it have dug a crater that you see in the ground outside that building. Fertilizer soaked in fuel is a slow-burning explosive. Whatever made that damage was a high explosive, fast burning, such as that used in military weapons. So, do with that what you will. That is what we know here. Local TV stations have been broadcasting all day that four arrests have been made in the bombing of a federal building in Oklahoma City. Information came to KWTV Channel 9 Television, a CBS affiliate, from an unnamed New York law enforcement source. That sounds suspiciously like the ADL, to tell you the truth. Asad Siddiqui and Mohammed Chafi were arrested in Dallas, Texas. Now listen to this, folks. These people may be Islamic, and they may be from the Middle East, but they are not stupid. They ask a highway patrolman for directions. The officer noticed that the license plate number did not match the number which should have been on their vehicle, so he arrested them. This was a rental car. It is not unusual for rental car companies to receive several different rental cars in brand new from the factory, throw the plates and a bunch of stickers to some 14-year-old kid and tell him to go out and put them on the cars. And sometimes they get mixed up. I'm not saying that's what's happened here, but I don't think someone who blew up the federal building in Oklahoma City would stop a highway patrolman in asking for directions if they had a phony plate on their car. You see, Islamic fundamentalist or Middle East does not equate to stupid. And if you don't believe me, find some people from the Middle East who belong to the Islamic religion and talk to them, and you'll find out that they're very smart. The officer noticed that the license plate number did not match and arrested them. The brother of Siddiqui was also arrested at some undisclosed place in Oklahoma. A fourth suspect was arrested at Heathrow Airport in Great Britain after being identified by an immigration agent, and this unnamed suspect was traveling with a U.S. passport and had taken a flight out of Chicago to Heathrow. Our sources say that he is not a suspect and he is not a witness. But that he was filming in that area that morning. The Associated Press was making the announcement about the arrest in Britain. And we got the information about the other three arrests. Britain is presently detaining the fourth suspect and has agreed to have him returned to the United States. Once again, I will tell you, the man being detained in Britain is not a suspect. Our station chief penned a little note to me. She says, "I get it, but I don't. What stupid ways for all of those guys to get arrested. Nobody is really that stupid. Maybe they wanted to be arrested, or maybe they were somehow set up with the FBI running the show. We'll probably hear the real story." And then she sent me another fax and said she was real sleepy when she wrote that, and she meant, "We'll probably never hear the real story." And she says, "This one doesn't pass muster. Even the local newscasters are reporting this latest episode with slightly raised eyebrows. There's not something right here." I'm going to take a short nap, Bill. My engine has temporarily run out of steam. God bless all. Michelle. She was up all night, as have been many other of our best people. And here's a report from David in Oklahoma City. "Today," this is him talking, "today I have the unfortunate task of visiting the most physically and spiritually intense place I have ever been in my entire life. That place is downtown Oklahoma City, which is now literally under martial law, just like you might imagine it in a nightmare. That place is downtown Oklahoma City, which is now literally under martial law, just like you might imagine it in a nightmare." He says, "I would estimate between 40,000 and 50,000 people in the downtown Oklahoma City area, evenly divided between civilians, law enforcement personnel, and members of the military. I observed many, many officers from Oklahoma City Police, Oklahoma National Guard, Oklahoma Highway Patrol, Oklahoma Department of Corrections, policemen from almost every city in the state, ATF, FBI, and firefighters from every possible area. Oddly enough, I even saw about 30 men wearing jackets which said Sacramento United States Army Reserve. There is no town in Oklahoma called Sacramento. Physically, it is the most controlled environment I've ever seen, and spiritually the most depressing. Thousands and thousands, no exaggeration, of people with two things on their mind, fear and grief. Thousands of press people from around the world are all trying to achieve the same thing, get the inside story, and no one is allowed to do so, not even the majors. There's now a total information blackout in downtown Oklahoma City. And the only people who are getting even close to the truth are intelligence service members and CAGI members. Why? Well, if I told you that, it wouldn't be any fun, would it?" After he found a parking place, which was a genuine miracle, he was putting money in the parking meter, and a civilian in a business suit walked past and said, quote, "You don't have to put any money in there. It's martial law in Oklahoma City," end quote. He says, "After I finally found a parking place," nope, I just read that paragraph. "When I was in Oklahoma City right at 12 noon, all of the press people were being sent to the Civic Center if they wanted any information at all, a bit more than a quarter mile walk from the federal building. None of the police or military personnel guarding the perimeter would say anything to the press, period. In fact, the press were segregated to one side of the street away from ordinary citizens like myself. Police officers would say, quote, anyone from the press move to that side of the street, end quote, and this order was obediently carried out. People like me were merely told to get out of the way. Armored personnel carriers, cargo trucks, Humvees, Jeeps, and extremely large electric generators lined the streets, every single street. Helicopters constantly buzzed the area at a very low altitude, just like you see in the movies, dodging in and out of the skyline, avoiding the buildings, and making quick lifts in altitude to avoid crashing into Oklahoma City's tallest building, Liberty Towers. Liberty Towers, indeed. Isn't this absolutely amazing? He goes on. He says, I spoke with five Oklahoma City police officers, one National Guardsman, and was shooed away from the intersection of 7th and Walker by a man in a black SWAT uniform whose OD identification patch read, Oklahoma Department of Corrections, Prisons. And this gets really ridiculous, folks. This is absolutely, in fact, amazing. This is a full drill takeover of an American city after a staged incident. That's right. If you were listening last night, you know why I say that. I've predicted it for a long time, and I'm going to tell you it's going to escalate, and it's all about more control of your lives by the government and eventually the United Nations, one world, totalitarian, socialist state. And you can listen to all these other blithering idiots, and you can banner around all these theories and all these things if you want to. What I just told you is right on the mark. And if it's not, how come I knew about it a long time ago? How come I wrote about it in my book? How come I told you New York City was going to be hit by a major terrorist attack? How come I knew that it would be blamed upon Islamic fundamentalists? How come I knew that they would have direct connections to the Central Intelligence Agency long before anybody else knew? How come I told you that more terrorist attacks would come and it would escalate, and the power of the state would escalate exponentially along with it? Don't go away. I might come back.
Some people say I'm a no-cop, others say I'm no good, but I'm just a microphone traveling man, doing what I think I should. Oh yeah, doing what I think I should.
The world of entertainment up here.
I don't give a damn about a green bag of tar. That's in the country of the shame. For a rain song and a stick is up. The only thing that I understand, good boy. The only thing that I understand.
When I was a little baby, and my mama said, hey son, travel where you will and grow to be a man. Sing what must be sung, for boy, you better sing what must be sung.
And I don't steal a damn fire, green bag of dollars. I send it back to the damn for a wailing song.
The Hour of the Time is brought to you, ladies and gentlemen, by Swiss America Trading. It's the only firm that deals in real money, hard assets, non-confiscatable, non-reportable hard assets, real money as defined in the statutes of the United States of America as being the only money for the United States of America, as defined in the Constitution. No state shall tender in payment of debts anything other than gold or silver coin, and that should tell you that the Constitution is not in effect. it was, you would have some gold or silver coin, or you would have some real currency. Currency is what can be exchanged for gold or silver coin. It takes the place of it. Receipts for storage, if you will. But you don't have any. You're going to need some. So call our sponsor, Swiss America Trading, 1-800-289-2646. And don't be so carefree. You see, every time you buy something with that phony counterfeit Federal Reserve notes, you don't really own it. That's why you stopped getting an allodial patent title to your land and began to be given warrant deeds, which warrant that a deed exists, but you don't have it because you're not the real owner. That's when you stopped getting the title to your car and began getting a certificate of title, because you don't own that car. You can't pay for something that has real value, substance, with an instrument of debt. Sooner or later, someone has to pay for all this stuff, or else the true owner will come and take it all back. You think I'm crazy, huh? Well, you just stick around. It's going to get worse fast. The United States Attorney General is a murderess. She murdered men, women, and little children in Waco, Texas, and now today on television, she had the guts to offer a $2 million reward for the instigators of the bombing of the federal building in Oklahoma City, and she said she was worried about our women and children. Call now and get your hands on some real money. You're going to need it. It might save your life one of these days. 1-800-289-2646. 1-800-289-2646. Have you counted the bodies surrounding Clinton yet? It's well over 30. One of these nights I'll have Linda Thompson on and we'll give you a count name by name and circumstance by circumstance. You don't want to know Clinton very well. You might end up dead.
The only thing that I understand is the war. The only thing that I understand.
Next week he'll learn how to play it on his guitar.
Now that I'm a grown man, I've traveled here and there. I've learned that a bottle of brandy and a song, the only ones who ever care. Oh boy, the only ones who ever care.
Well, no one, ladies and gentlemen, was allowed inside the perimeter in Oklahoma City without a pass. All passes are being issued by the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Our man asked the first policeman with whom he spoke how he could get in, and the policeman said, "You can't get in, but if you could get in, you would need a pass." He asked him how to get a pass, and he said, "Go stand in line at 8th and Walker." He did his best to follow the instructions. However, no one was allowed to stand in line without a pass. He asked a second policeman how he could get a pass from the FBI, and he said, "You can't." He asked the same question and received the exact same answer from a National Guardsman. He then asked a third policeman about the jurisdiction of the FBI and the Oklahoma City Police. He seemed confused, totally exhausted, and walked away without comment to do something that he thought was more important. A fourth police officer responded to that same question by saying, and I quote, "The FBI are in charge of the crime scene. The guy that's in charge of the crime scene drives the train. Get it?" Well, our man got it. The fifth policeman finally tackled the question, and we got his response on tape, and here is that little exchange. Listen carefully.
Let me update. Have you got a minute?
Yes, sir.
Okay. When I was watching TV last night, they were talking about how the crime scene itself was the building, and that it was for this country. Under the jurisdiction of the FBI.
That's right.
And then that the perimeter or the area around it was secured by Oklahoma State Police. Now, I was asking this fellow down here.
And there you have it. He said the whole area is a crime scene. The whole city is under martial law. The whole city is a crime scene. Our man on his fax says, wow. All of the police and military personnel in charge of the perimeter were extremely polite, but made it very clear they were not going to take any crap off of anybody. He uses another word here, but I can't use that on radio, or choose not to anyway. Occasionally, a young buck in uniform would act in a very Rambo-like manner, but most of the officials seemed as sad as everybody else that they had to be there. At 8th and Harvey, there was a never-ending line of firemen going in and out of the perimeter. He says, I was able to view the bombed building from a distance, as was anyone who wanted to do a bit of walking. The guarded perimeter encloses a 25-square-block area. The north boundary is 7th Street. The south is Robert S. Kerr Boulevard. The east is Broadway, and the west boundary is Hudson Street. The federal building looked much worse in real life than it did on television, and there is a 30-foot diameter crater in front of the building. Glass literally carpets the streets. I parked about 6 blocks away from the perimeter and walked to the nearest vantage point, and there was glass strewn everywhere for the entire distance. The street was also littered with horse manure, as if there had been mounted police on duty, but I didn't see any officers on horseback. One business I walked past had a stack of plywood out in front with a sign on it that said, plywood, $15 a sheet. Glass companies were everywhere, replacing windows and doors. I met a nice lady from Norway who was with the press. She got nowhere trying to get inside the perimeter. She was accompanied by a sound man and cameraman who seemed surprised that I knew what a Shure mic mixer was. I also met a man from Los Angeles who was with the press and was very angry that he was going to have to walk all the way to the Civic Center to find out anything. Well, if you ever lived in Los Angeles, you'd understand that. No one in Los Angeles walks. Except the poor. The very poor. Los Angeles is an automobile-oriented city. If you don't have a car, you are nothing. So understandably, somebody from Los Angeles who would be angry if he had to walk a couple of blocks. He says, I spoke to him about the issue of jurisdiction between the federal and local authorities, and he merely shrugged his shoulders and said, and I quote, these people can do anything they want to, and we can't do a thing about it, end quote. He was a member of the press. And that's the way it is. It's martial law, and the federal government is clearly in charge. Ain't no doubt about it. More later, as it occurs, Dave. And the last dispatch from Oklahoma City from our station chief, which we received just a few moments ago. At this hour, rescue workers have recovered 52 bodies from the scene of the explosion. Remember last night, the government was saying over 80 were dead? It was a lie. Nobody knows how many are dead. It will probably exceed 80. But at this time, there are only 52 dead bodies that have been recovered from the scene of the explosion. The precarious condition of the building allows only 40 firefighters at a time to work in 90-minute shifts, wearing protective gear, gloves, ventilation masks, and respirators. A telephone number was established for people to call who had been in the building at the time of the explosion. From the responses to that call, it has been determined that 700 people, which includes approximately 400 injured persons, survived the explosion. There are now at least an additional 150 persons still missing in the rubble and debris, and the number could be higher. The First Christian Church has taken information from all of the families of the missing, obtaining physical descriptions, dental records, and information concerning what items of clothing or jewelry the missing persons might have been wearing on the day of the explosion. The bodies of the dead victims will be removed from the temporary morgue set up on the west side of the federal building tomorrow. The governor has declared tomorrow a day of statewide mourning, and boy, you can tell it's election time. President and Mrs. Clinton are expected to attend, accompanied by the Reverend Billy Graham. Flags have been lowered to half-staff. The Federal Bureau of Investigation agent in charge of the on-site investigation is Weldon Kennedy. We learned late last night that our station chief's brother-in-law's father had been in the federal building at 8 a.m. doing some early morning business and had left the building at 8:30 a.m. to return to his office. 34 minutes later, the explosion occurred. We thank God that none of our people or any of their relatives were in that building. From our station chief, more later, signed Michele. We've got about 15 minutes, folks. We'll open the phones and get your comments, your remarks. Maybe some of you were there and can tell us what you saw. The number is 602-337-2524. That's 602-337-2524, and we'll take your calls for the rest of this hour. Once again, for those who may have just begun listening to the hour of the time, 602-337-2524. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hello?
Hello?
I'm calling up about yesterday on Chuck Carter's show, where somebody called up about his fiance being in the building and getting out 1 minute after the explosion. She was in the lobby, and she said that there was a huge black helicopter hovering over the building 1 minute after getting out. It wasn't 5 minutes or 10 minutes later after the explosion had gotten around town and everybody knew about it. She claimed she saw this happening.
We've heard this also, but we can find no substantiation from anybody who was on the scene. And until we do, we can't report that as being fact, and we don't like to spread rumors. So, but we thank you for that input.
And also, I'd like to ask, why aren't they letting all the stations go right up to the front of the building? It sounds like the same thing as Waco, where they moved everybody back while they threw away the evidence.
Ah, the light went off in your head.
Yeah.
You're thinking.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome. You see, the press could be allowed to go pretty close to that building without hampering or interfering with anybody. What is happening in Oklahoma City is way beyond what is called for. It's almost like a war-torn city invaded by an occupying force. In fact, that's exactly what it is. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. This is Bob from Rhode Island. I talked to you before. One thing I just wanted to put out there is that when we get a list of the number of judges and FBI agents, Secret Service agents, and other officers that were in that building, perhaps how many have died, then we'll get a better handle on exactly who might have been the perpetrators in this activity.
The perpetrators are in Langley, Virginia, my friend.
Well, is there any list available yet?
Not that I know of, but you should be able to get a list directly out of the Oklahoma City phone book of the offices that were in that building.
No, I mean the offices, the individuals, the FBI agents, the Secret Service agents, the judges.
This was an attack on an individual. This was an attack on the American people.
Yes, I understand that.
By a socialist totalitarian...
You know what I'm getting at is if all of these judges and officials were on assignment somewhere else that day, that they weren't in the building, and only the expendable people were in there, like from the agricultural department,
oh, well, that
the offices, you follow me?
That could be an interesting pursuit, and I think we have somebody already checking that out.
Good. I'll be waiting for that information. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for calling. Folks, when you call, try to get to the point. Don't play guessing games, because I can't read your mind. I've never claimed to be psychic. All of my friends can tell you that I have never demonstrated any psychic ability whatsoever, except maybe a little bit in Vietnam when the hair used to stand up on the back of my neck. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, Bill. This is Michelle in Oklahoma.
Hello.
I spoke with the other intelligence service person that you connected me with. She called me this afternoon to tell me that her connections observed Connie Chung arriving in a limousine, and she had no problem whatsoever getting what she wanted. So we should be seeing something on the news pretty soon with Connie Chung on the scene.
Oh, you mean no press were allowed to approach, but Connie Chung was able to drive right up to the building in a limousine?
Allegedly so. Not right up to the federal building, no, but right up to whoever she wanted to see on the scene.
Uh-huh.
You would need to call back your intelligence operative on that particular issue, but this is just what she told me this afternoon.
Okay.
And then the latest thing that's coming down the pike is that Janet Reno is issuing a $2 million reward for information leading to the arrest and conviction of whoever did it, and now they're looking for two Caucasian males.
Yes.
So that's Janet Reno was asked if she had any hunches, and she just said, I don't do hunches.
Oh, she just burns women and children.
Right. But I thought I'd pass that on because I couldn't get it to you in time before your show began.
Thank you, Michelle.
You're welcome.
By the way, folks, that is the Michelle.
Good night.
And I don't know if she's going to be up all night tonight or not. Also, folks, we're changing our area code number here, and I keep forgetting to give it to you. The new area code is 520. So from now on, you'll call 520-337-2524, and the 2524 is going to change beginning Monday, and I'll give you that number tomorrow night. So make sure that you're listening. Good evening. You're on the air.
William, this is Paul on the left coast.
Hello, Paul.
Really enjoy your show.
Thank you.
As a matter of fact, I came over and bought some property in Sholo. I'm still trying to get back to put something on it, but I'll do that.
Wonderful.
Had you heard that the University of Oklahoma recorded two blasts on their their seismometer?
No, I had not heard that. And
something that could be checked out. I have no idea if it's true. But
well, we'll certainly find out. This is the first that I've heard of it, and it was not announced on any of the local stations in Oklahoma City. Where did you hear this?
I can believe that. I truly can't tell you now. Somewhere on the Patriot Networks, I just picked it up. But it would be simple enough to find out.
Oh, very easy to find out. We have people right in Norman, Oklahoma, where the University of Oklahoma is at. And we will send somebody right over there. In fact, probably somebody listening is on their way
probably.
Right now. Right now, I'll bet.
Listen, thanks a lot for the sanity. I've been away from my shortwave, and I've been having to watch this stuff and try to interpret between the lines, and your take on it sounds a hell of a lot more reasonable to me than anything I've heard in the last few days.
Oh, it's right on the money. I can guarantee you this is exactly what's going on.
Well, I believe it. I hate to think that they would do it, but it certainly is self-serving whether they did or didn't.
Yeah. The end justifies the means is their philosophy, ordo ab caeo.
Why, this is going to burnish so many people. Look at what it does to the BATF.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, look what it does to the FBI. Look,
sure.
The president's looking presidential now.
Oh, yeah, and how convenient. It just buried the whole issue of Waco, Texas, didn't
Got
it?
Got it. It's gone.
Well, it's not gone here.
Scopes. I bet you Congress doesn't even talk about it.
It's not gone here. And we'll talk about it. We'll rub their noses in it.
I understand.
Janet Reno is a murderer.
You got it.
William Clinton is a murderer.
She should be standing trial. And Congress was going to get into, well, they say they were going to get into Waco. And I bet you they don't now.
Well, what they're going to get into is the omnibus counterterrorism bill.
It'll be pushed through. If they want to get reelected, they'll figure that they've got to vote for it. Ridiculous. Anyway, keep up the good work.
Thank you for calling.
Bye-bye.
520-337-2524. That's 520-337-2524. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, I wanted to see if anybody there had heard early in CNN's coverage, an FBI agent whose name I don't remember because I was too sleepy at the time, reported that there had been faxed warnings to the building.
Well, we know that is correct.
Is it? Okay, because since I saw that, I got the videotape pop in, and nothing I've videotaped since then off CNN has even mentioned that factoid. That has been reported later on?
Yeah, not only that, but we have, and I'm looking for it here. I wasn't going to report it tonight, but maybe I will. Nope, that's not it either. We have a report from people on the scene from a United States Navy super top secret installation that the day before, which was Tuesday, they held a bomb drill in one of their major installation buildings. And the drill involved an explosive in a car in the front of the building exactly the day before.
Uh-huh.
We also have from other people in government installations that they were informed that there would be a terrorist attack on a government building sometime soon. And so these kinds of drills and things were going on all across the country. So somebody knew something.
Yeah.
And some facilities were preparing in case they were the target.
Cool. By the way, I also heard the same report as your previous caller had about the two blasts being recorded on the seismograph.
Well, that fits with our assessment. We had not heard that, but my assessment of the damage there was that there had to be two explosives.
Yeah, absolutely. Keep up the good work, Bill.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Good night. 520-337-2524. That's interesting. I've got to find out the source of that. We will get somebody to Oklahoma University and check with the, I guess it would be the geology department, which would be running the seismographs, and we will let you know what we discover. Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening. Bill, I remember when you were talking shortly after the World Trade Center bombing, and you said when this would escalate, you know, eventually the people would, beg for a solution, give up their freedom. And I hate to say it, but down here in a local newscast in Beaumont, Texas, they had a telepoll, and the question was, and really woke me up when I saw the question. It says, would you be willing to give up your personal freedom, you know, to be more secure from terrorist attacks? And the percentage was about 78% said yes. And it just goes to show you how far everyone is behind in their thinking and everything.
I hate being right.
Yeah. I mean, when I saw that, I said, golly,
Yeah, but it's exactly what I told you would happen, isn't it?
It's exactly what you said would happen.
Not only that, but they phrased the question in almost the exact words that I phrased it, didn't they?
You know, I'm wondering, I know some people down at that station. I'm going to call them and ask them where they got that question, if they just came up with it, or if it was something off a wire or something like that. But yeah, it's exactly what you said. It's almost like you're a psychic. I know you're not.
No, I'm not. I've just done hard work for many, many years, and I know what's happening.
Yeah. Well, I tell you what, I'm really watching close, and I'm really seeing the things that I wouldn't have seen, you know, probably a couple of years ago before I started listening to your show and, you know, looking out, looking at the world in a different way. But I just wanted to tell you about that. It's an unfortunate thing, though.
Yes, it is. Very unfortunate. And somebody should talk to the citizens of Beaumont, Texas, and tell them how absolutely stupid they are.
Yeah, I'm going to try that.
78%, huh?
78%.
Incredible. You watch that question will be asked across the country.
That's what I'm looking forward to. I'm not looking forward to it.
And don't be surprised if there's a nationwide poll.
Yeah, on ABC or something like
that. On network television, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Hey, thanks for the information. This is really, really, really great work you're doing. Thanks.
You're welcome. Good night.
All right.
Got time for one more call, folks, and that's it. 520-337-2524. If you get in, make your question or comment real short because we're out of time. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi. This is Michelle from Montana.
Hello.
And I was you were mentioning that there were all the military vehicles in Oklahoma City.
Yes.
And Sunday afternoon, we live up above the railroad, we were watching, and there was a long train went by with just all kinds of, like, Humvees and all kinds of military vehicles heading east, which we've not seen before.
Uh-huh.
And we thought that was kind of interesting.
Okay, thank you for your comment. We're out of time. Well, folks, yes, there is more movement of military equipment, material, and vehicles in this country today than there ever was in World War II or Vietnam. Now, you'd better start asking yourself why and what's it leading to. I know the answer to that, and so do some of you, but the rest of you, if you've been reading issue number 2 of Veritas, but you get your head out of your you-know-what. Seek the light somewhere else. Good night, folks, and God bless each and every single one of you.
I'm walking, just being on top, but you and me, I'm hoping, and there's you somewhere to you. I'm lonely, and I can be young, wait, but you'll come to me, I'm hoping, and there's you somewhere to you. Now what you gonna do when the bell was right? You gonna run away and hide? I'm gonna run right by inside. You pretty baby, I ain't running down more. Here's a dream I'm for. But you and me, I'm hope. Then you come back here for. But you and me, I'm hoping that you come back to me. I'm lonely, as I be your way. For your company, I'm hoping that you come back to me. Now what you gonna do when the railroad's right? You're gonna run away and hide. I'm gonna run right by your side. You pretty baby, I need a little more. Here's the deed I'm calling, but you and me, I'm hoping that you come back to me.
I'm William Cooper, and you're listening to the Hour of the Time. And I know many of you have been waiting patiently through all the crap today to hear what's really going on. First, I have an order from the Commanding General of the 2nd Continental Army of the Republic. All militias are to remain on full alert. Militia commanders are to maintain discipline of their units. Every unit is to protect their leadership, and under no circumstances are you to allow the militia to be broken as a result of the propaganda campaign being waged against the legitimate, legal militia of the several states and of the United States of America. I was right, ladies and gentlemen, in a bullet poll conducted by KTBS-TV Channel 3, Shreveport, Louisiana, and reported on 20 April 1995, the following question was asked. Would you be willing to give up some of your freedom for a little security? In the categories none, some, most, all are undecided. 74% of the respondents fell into the category bracketed by some, most, or all. This means, ladies and gentlemen, that of those polled and responding, 74% view their freedom as a negotiable instrument to be traded for a small amount of security, ostensibly to be needed by our flawed Marxist-controlled federal government. Don't go away, you're going to hear the truth. The only truth that you've heard all day long, you're going to hear in just a moment. You listen very carefully all the way through this broadcast and all the way through the closing musical selection. Every word, every bar of music tonight is extremely important.
My dissatisfied fellow countrymen, and not in mine, is the momentous issue of civil war. You can have no conflict without being yourselves the aggressor. You have no oath registered in heaven to destroy the government, while I shall have the most solemn one to preserve, protect, and defend it. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strength, it must not break our bond of affection.
Ladies and gentlemen, just as I predicted, today the attacks began. The great herd of sheeple out there have fallen directly into the dialectic. It is working exactly as it was planned. Hegel, if he were here, would be smiling from ear to ear. That much is certain. From our station chief, this morning around 10 a.m., two press conferences were held simultaneously. We have information from both of them. One meeting was held by FBI on-site director Weldon Kennedy. He stated that the man who was stopped at Heathrow Airport is being questioned and has been completely cooperative, and as I stated last night, is not a suspect. He reaffirmed that this man is not a suspect, but it is an alleged witness. He made no mention at all of the other three men who were arrested, nor did the press ask any questions about them. Kennedy stated that the FBI recovered film from a surveillance camera located atop a nearby building, which may or may not contain any pictorial record of the vehicle, which may have contained explosives. He said the film has been damaged. Well, what did you expect? Really, what did you expect? Of course the film was damaged. It might show something. And the experts are doing their best to enhance what images do exist on the film. And when any info is available, in this matter, we'll all be notified. Don't hold your breath. Don't even hold your breath. Bomb forensic experts on the scene have been collecting evidence. Platinum wires, bits of plastic were the only two items Kennedy specifically mentioned. The same items that were mentioned on the first day as having been stored in the office of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms, along with a rocket launcher. The actual type and size of the bomb is still not known. Kennedy is still estimating that it was several thousand pounds of explosive materials. The experts are attempting to determine the type of accelerants used, and we know exactly what it was. Ladies and gentlemen, it was fulminate of mercury. Fulminate of mercury. Several cans of it did not detonate and were found intact near the elevator shaft. This information comes directly from a high-ranking official on the scene. The second press conference was held by the medical examiner. He stated that at 10 a.m. the official death count was 57. Since then, we know that it has risen to 60. 36 of those bodies were removed from the sealed perimeter area of the explosion, and only 21 of them actually have come from the building wreckage itself. He stated that it has been very difficult to actually determine a death count because so many body parts are being brought out of the wreckage. The medical workers attempt to match those body parts with other portions of bodies which are in storage, and from that reach a number of deceased. The bodies and parts, once removed from the debris, are taken to a medical examination preliminary holding area. They've stopped calling it the temporary morgue. A part of this holding area is comprised of several refrigerator trucks, which are used to store these parts to prevent further deterioration. When an actual complete body is recovered, it is taken to the medical examiner's working area, which has been set up in a local church building nearby. There are over 100 persons working in this area, including forensic pathologists, x-ray technicians, dental examiners, radiologists, and representatives from the FBI Fingerprint Records Division. Upon arriving at the church examination area, each body is first taken to the initial examination room where items of clothing are removed and personal effects, if any, are collected. It has been stated that the injuries of the bodies examined so far have been consistent with blast injuries, and the bodies exhibit extreme trauma of one sort that you might expect from flying concrete, glass shards, falling steel beams, collapsing ceilings, falling and flying office equipment of all kinds, etc. The medical examiner stated that the most difficult body identifications are, of course, the children. Most of the children have no fingerprints on file anywhere, have not been living long enough to accumulate any significant medical records, and many had not yet acquired any dental records. Look for a law to be passed mandating that your children be fingerprinted shortly after birth. Some footprints taken at birth have been provided, but this seems to be the only immediate clue the examiner's office has for any of the identification of the children's bodies. At this time, only one child has been positively identified, a one-year-old. The medical examiner stressed that at this time, no matter what the press may be saying or may have reported, only five actual names of victims have been officially released. He said if you didn't get your identification of victims' information from him personally, and he holds two press conferences daily, then the information cannot be considered accurate. He stated that when identifications are positively made, the manner of death recorded on the death certificate is homicide. When a body examination is completed, whether or not an identification can be made, the body is then returned to the refrigerator trucks for storage. FEMA is sending in additional equipment and personnel to assist the medical examiner and his people. Primarily needed has been self-contained examination equipment, which the branches of the military's medical departments are providing. At this moment, the medical examiner has approximately 100 bodies and or body parts which are being examined and for which identifications are being attempted. He stressed that until the examinations determine that the body parts actually comprise a single individual, no number is added to the official death count. At this time, traffic into, out of, and around the sealed perimeter has increased threefold from what it was on Wednesday and Thursday. Almost all cars are driving with headlights on as an indication of mourning. It has been announced on radio that shortly after the explosion, an unnamed employee of Ecro Feed Company, which is located on Martin Luther King Boulevard, contacted investigating officials and said that he remembered selling a large amount of ammonium nitrate fertilizer to several men of Middle Eastern appearance. It was a lie. Today it was announced that the feed company owner carefully examined all of the company's invoices for the last 4 months and no such sale was made to anyone in that period of time. When large amounts of this fertilizer are sold to farms and agricultural companies, there is a record kept for the federal government of the purchase and the purchaser. It was also announced that the type of fertilizer which this company has sold recently is not the type which would be used in an explosive. No further mention was made of the employee who called in the erroneous report, and he has not been identified. It was also not revealed whether or not that employee still held his job. In fact, we don't even know that it was really an employee of that company. Also at this time, rescue workers on the scene are in what is being called a wicker basket, being lifted by a crane. And they've been searching parts of the eighth floor of the federal building, working downward. At last check, I believe that they were working downward from the third floor. The wind in the area has increased, and it was stated that the search may have to be temporarily halted or suspended because of the danger of falling debris from the upper stories of the building, and throughout the day there have been occasional pauses in the rescue work because of this danger. As of 12:35 p.m., workers were taken from the face of the building and are now working again in the basement area. The danger of falling office equipment and debris from the upper stories onto the rescue workers brought this about by the high winds and caused this move. Rescue workers have located several pockets in the wreckage containing bodies. No estimated number has been released, and no bodies have yet been removed from those pockets. Simultaneously with all of the rescue work, local businesses and individuals have poured donations of all kinds into the area. Southwestern Bell Pioneer Community Group has established four supply drop-off points and are requesting specifically men's clothing and personal toiletry items, because almost all of the rescue workers, when called to the scene, dropped everything they were doing and arrived with nothing more, ladies and gentlemen, than the clothes on their back. Urgent calls have been made for men's underclothing, shaving kits, toothbrushes, shirts, socks, shoes, coats, etc. Also needed is food, water, paper products, and medical supplies. Donations are also being taken by the Salvation Army, the Feed the Children organization, the Disaster Relief Organization of the B'nai B'rith, and all of the local churches. The Guardian Funeral Home is donating funeral services for the children killed in the explosion. The Flowers by Pat Floral Company is donating flowers and taking cash donations for the funeral services of the other victims. A company in Edmond, Oklahoma has donated many sets of doggy boots, which are flexible but impenetrable boots to be worn by the bomb dogs being worked on the scene. because the dog's having tremendous difficulties walking over the debris. The same company also donated huge amounts of dog food for the working dogs. The Fort Howard Paper Company plant in Muskogee, Oklahoma, has donated a semi-truckload of paper products, napkins, towels, bathroom tissue, etc., all of which are badly needed by the rescue workers, the security personnel, and the workers in the medical examiner's area. Oklahoma Bank, Boatman's Bank, and the Bank of Oklahoma have all established victims' disaster relief funds to assist the surviving family members in whatever way may be necessary. Persons and companies with donated goods which have been specifically requested from the security personnel and rescue workers are being told to take them to the supply drop-off area located at 8th and Harvey. A colonel with the Oklahoma Army National Guard was interviewed today on radio because the presence of uniformed military personnel at the First Christian Church upset the citizens. The colonel stated that the state military reserve organizations have been posted in two places to do two specific jobs. Primarily, they're being used to secure the perimeter of the crime scene, and their secondary function is to work at the First Christian Church in support of the Red Cross and the Oklahoma City Police Department directing traffic in the parking lot, which is at times an overwhelming task, and to act as escorts for the grieving family members who have been arriving nonstop at the church since the explosion. At this time, there are over 500 family members at the church giving information, waiting for announcements, and trying to help each other as best they can. It was announced today on radio that Peter Jennings had made remarks about civilian militia and the possibility that this bombing might have been caused by a local group rather than an international terrorist group, and then it began. Exactly as I predicted, it turned and shifted and aimed directly at the militia of the several states and of the United States. At 12:45 p.m., John Belmont of ABC News made this official statement. This is a direct quote transcribed from a tape made from the radio. Quote, sources say things are happening very fast now in the investigation. We earlier reported this now looks more like a domestic case than international terrorism. John Belmont reports the investigation is focusing on government-hating groups. He provides some background information. John Belmont then says this. And the report cuts in the middle of a sentence. Quote, in the groups, particularly in light of a newsletter sent out by the Montana militia in March, signaling April 19th, the day of the bombing, as an extremely important day. Not only was it the second anniversary of what happened at Waco, it was also the date set for the execution of a white extremist in Arkansas, who in fact was executed. He had been convicted of killing a Jewish businessman and a black policeman and showed no remorse. And according to authorities, that has been, there was a skip in the broadcast at that point, it picks up at now and looking at a possible motive for the bombing, end quote. At 1 p.m., it was announced that a raid was being made in Decker, Michigan, in connection with the bombing in Oklahoma City and a civilian militia group there. While the local radio broadcaster was waiting for the signal from ABC News to begin the Belmont report, he remarked that it might be important to look into the issue of civilian militias because they have been cropping up all over the state. He then specifically mentioned Moore, Oklahoma, Norman, Oklahoma, and Eufaula, Oklahoma, as places where civilian militia were known to exist. He also made mention of the fact that Richard Wayne Snell, the man executed in Arkansas, had been arrested in Oklahoma prior to being taken to Arkansas for trial, and the insanity has continued all day long. When discussing the sketches of possible suspects which have been published in all the papers and flashed on television screens everywhere, the KTOK broadcaster made mention there is some kind of bad blood between the FBI and the CIA, combined with some claimed but unsubstantiated name-calling between the two groups. The broadcaster said that a rumor is now floating that much dissension is igniting between the two organizations because allegedly one group knew about activities leading to the explosion in advance of the event and did not tell the other organization. That's absolutely correct, folks. The Central Intelligence Agency is the one that blew up the building. The broadcaster did not specify which organization might have had the advanced information, nor did he tell us the names of anyone who might have made the rumored remarks, and at this time, no further elaboration on the subject has been made. At 1:15 p.m., official ABC News release states that the bombing is now officially related to the Waco Massacre. And our station chief here inserts a personal remark, "Bill, things are moving very, very fast all of a sudden here. I'm going to have to leave the house and get on up to Oklahoma City. When all this stuff began happening, I had run back to the house to send this fax. I'll just have to contact you later, regardless of what news releases may be made, because I'm going to be away from the computer for several hours. I need an assistant here. Help. A dependable one. Dave is out on assignment in the Oklahoma University campus area and will not be back here for some time." And I give you these remarks, folks, so that you'll know that these people are human just like you. As you might expect, most of the militia-related remarks in connection with this bombing are being made by national news agencies, not the local ones. Until ABC brought this matter into the mix, no one in Oklahoma, after those first remarks from day one, had made any comments about militia, and until the national news convinced the local radio people that what is being said is plausible, they are hesitant to badmouth any patriotic organization. And because patriotism is still admired and encouraged in Oklahoma, the only way the national rumor mongers are going to be able to promote the militia involvement rumor is by simultaneously tying it to a racist group, and you heard that all day long. White supremacist, religious fundamentalist, constitutionist, patriot groups, government haters. The truth is, even in the backwoods hick country of Oklahoma, investigators are not likely to find too many groups which are both racist and patriotic at the same time. And folks, in my investigations, in this entire nation, there are probably 500 total white supremacists. Period. You can be certain that whoever is arrested will be first proclaimed a racist, and later a militia connection will be fabricated. Here's the report from Dave, the report of two seismological events consistent with large explosions on the morning of April 19, 1995 is confirmed. At 1:20 p.m. today, 4/21/95, I spoke with Dr. Luza of the Oklahoma Geological Survey, which is located in the Sarkey Energy Building at the University of Oklahoma campus. Dr. Luza showed me the seismograph recordings made on that morning showing two separate seismological disturbances, the first occurring at 9:02:04 a.m. and the second occurring at 9:02:14 a.m. He said the two events were approximately 10 seconds apart, give or take a few milliseconds. He showed me charts that illustrated what a train looks like on a seismograph, also what heavy traffic on the freeway would look like, and then he gave me a copy of the seismograph readings, which we have here in our possession at the research center. The two events are approximately the same in magnitude, and the peaks and the spaces between the peaks are consistent with what Dr. Luza said they refer to as a quarry blast. Dr. Luza said he could not confirm the actual location of the seismological events from the graphic record, except that both events were in the Oklahoma City area. At that time in the morning, the only blast that occurred in Oklahoma City occurred in the federal building, and there were two distinct, separate explosions. The people who worked at the seismographic lab stated unequivocally that they didn't care what the government said, that these were, without any doubt, two separate explosions of approximately the same magnitude. He stated that there have been no reports as to where the second event may have occurred that are consistent with what the government has reported as a single blast. As far as the actual seismographic record is concerned, there were definitely two events, and they both took place in Oklahoma City within 10 seconds of each other. Dr. Luther stated that the Oklahoma Geological Survey has sensors placed all over the state, and the time between when the first sensors record an event and the time the event arrives at their headquarters allows them to determine the approximate location of the event. Dr. Luza's secretary stated that ABC News representatives were in their offices this morning. Four or five different newspapers have also asked similar questions to Dave's. However, they got the same answers that we got, ladies and gentlemen, and yet They reported entirely different information, which should tell you that the press ain't playing with a full deck. In fact, they're intentionally lying. I've had reporters calling me all day long from newspapers and from television stations, and my answer to each and every single one of them when they request an interview is the same. Listen to my broadcast and go yourself. And it will continue to be my answer. There are no journalists in this country who have the guts to report the truth. They are engaged, in fact, in treason. Here's another report from Dave. I've been out talking to people all day in the Norman area. All of them have been local business owners in the University of Oklahoma campus area. There's a very high vigilante sentiment prevalent in the people to whom I spoke. People are rejoicing over the fact that the alleged perpetrators have been caught and have described to me various ways in which they should be punished and executed. One woman said, "I'm against the death penalty, but I think they deserve cruel and unusual punishment." Never mind, they have not been brought to trial, nor have they been convicted of anything, nor has it been proven that any of them are members of any militia, and I can assure you they are not. We've been trying to get confirmation from KTOK Radio about the reports made on Wednesday pertaining to the explosives and plastic found in the debris of the building, which was said to have been kept in the offices of the BATF. Several people in the Oklahoma City area reported that information to the research center here. Two of them knew each other, four others did not. They all heard the same report. That initial report was later followed by the announcement that a rocket launcher had been found in the rubble, also from the BATF office. At this time, we've talked to one representative at KTOK, and all of those Wednesday remarks are being denied. It is being said that the reports were never made and that we must surely be mistaken. And ladies and gentlemen, we are absolutely not mistaken. Those reports were made. KTOK is now lying, covering up. We don't know who told them to cover up. We don't know if they were threatened. We don't know what happened. But they are now denying reports that they clearly made on Wednesday. Early this afternoon, shortly before 2 p.m., the search and rescue work was stopped while all workers were moved back a safe distance from the federal building. Nothing more was said about why that occurred until 5:15 p.m., when it was reported that glass panels from the ninth floor were in danger of falling on the workers. Additionally, the stability of the east wall of the building was brought into question. The work was resumed within an hour of the announcement of the work stop, and nothing has changed in regard to the stability of the east wall. Workers did go up to the ninth floor and break the glass panels, allowing the glass to fall onto the piles of debris below. Agents of the FBI, the ATF, and officers from the Oklahoma City Police Department have been scouring the rooftops of all surrounding buildings. This extensive roof search began immediately after the workers were moved back from the federal building. It has not been announced what is being sought, and no reasons have been given for any investigation into any other building. The perimeter of the sealed and secured crime scene has been greatly enlarged. The boundaries are now Klassen Boulevard on the west, 10th Street on the north, Oklahoma Street on the east. We did not catch the name of the south boundary. If it has not changed, it is still Robert S. Kerr Boulevard. We'll get this information probably to you Monday. That's the soonest we can get it, since we don't broadcast over the weekend. No reason has been given for this change of perimeter. It has been announced that the number of Oklahoma National Guard troops on duty in the security area will be doubled this weekend. Why? What is going on here? They are going to double the Oklahoma National Guard troops on duty this weekend. Additionally, we found out there are mounted police on duty in the crime scene area and additional MPs from the 745th Military Police Company will be brought in this weekend as a violation of the Posse Comitatus Act. One pool radio announcer will be allowed inside the sealed perimeter, nobody else. And one pool television cameraman. In an interview with Oklahoma City attorney Tony Lacey, it was learned that one of the arrested suspects, 27-year-old Timothy McVeigh, is going to be transported to Tinker Air Force Base and will be arraigned before a federal magistrate at that location. Lacey could only speculate about why the suspect would not be arraigned at a state government location. He supposed that the condition of the courthouse behind the federal building was the reason for the Tinker substitution. Not at all, ladies and gentlemen. The federal government doesn't want to take any chances at losing jurisdiction, which means they will arraign him with a federal judge, federal magistrate, on federal property, and the state will have no claim on the suspects. That is the truth. Lacey also stated that he did not think that McVeigh would be incarcerated at Tinker, but would be moved to the new federal transfer center located near the Will Rogers International Airport on the southwest side of Oklahoma City, because the center had officially opened last month, right in time. Isn't that convenient? Right on time. It has extraordinarily secure isolation cells. Lacey said that it would probably be necessary to isolate McVeigh to protect him from the public and from other prisoners who might decide to kill him. Why? Nobody knows if he's even done anything yet. The body count now stands officially at 65 at this hour, of which only 13 have been positively identified, two of them children. The medical examiner has dispatched off their bodies. Don't go away. I'll be right back. There's a lot more to follow. Broadcast. Some of you may recognize that phrase. For those of you who do not, you'll recognize it before this broadcast is over, I can assure you. The world will little note nor long remember. An axle from a one-ton truck has been found one block from the federal building and is believed to be the axle from the vehicle used in the explosion. We do not recall hearing any official statement that the investigation has definitely determined that a vehicle bomb had been used in this incident. Things are happening out of order. And it is becoming increasingly difficult to make sense of some of the reports. Many things that we are hearing contradict direct testimony of eyewitnesses and persons who managed to escape from the building unharmed. Some official reports almost sound like they are talking about some other event rather than this one. Reporters at the scene with binoculars and telephoto lenses on their cameras are making reports about what they are actually observing, but official spokespersons either never address those matters or deny that the report was accurate. We tend to trust the actual eyes and ears of local people on the scene, so things are becoming increasingly confusing from an information standpoint. And the national news media are making many erroneous and blatantly false reports. CNN announced today the three arrests related to the bombing in Oklahoma City. Two of them are the Nichols brothers from Michigan. Their house has been surrounded with black-clad law enforcement officials with FBI shields. They are said to be members of a radical paramilitary organization called the Militia of Michigan.
Oh, boy. We knew this was going to happen. All of the above is continuing right now and all day and on into the night. CNN will be milking all it can from the whole radical militia movement material. It began on ABC early this morning. Peter Jennings was the first one. They talk about how militias are anti-gun control, anti-foreigners, white supremacists, etc., anti-Semitic, religious fundamentalists. They are really going after it. This is a definite development in their agenda of vilifying the patriots and the militias across the country. This is it, the beginning of the attack. I've told you all along that the militia of Montana and others are agent provocateurs. They would fuel the flames and provide the ammunition that would be used against the legitimate militias across this nation. And I was absolutely correct. They are reading Militia of Montana material and all the other BS that some militias deal with, such as racism. Watch this carefully. It is absolutely needless for me to say, but this is very, very serious. There was a poll conducted, ladies and gentlemen. Which government do you trust to handle running things? State, 69%, federal, 27%. Fighting crime, state, 71%, federal, 26%. Setting rules on welfare eligibility, state, 69%, federal, 27%. Workplace safety, state, 55%, federal, 42%. I'm not going to read the rest because the federal government lost on every count. The American people have lost faith in the federal government, and as the federal government continues to lie to the American people, they will continue to lose faith. On May 17, 1994, the state of Oklahoma, ladies and gentlemen, in their legislature passed H.R. 1047. H.R. 1047 made Oklahoma the very first state in the United States to actually go on record as opposing the approaching New World Order. It called for the United States not to lend military personnel to support the United Nations and many other things. Want to know why it happened in Oklahoma City? Reuters, for the second time in 2 years, assailants using a rented truck to transport a massive bomb have killed innocent people, injured thousands, and thrown an American city into panic. Listen to this, and they have, for the second time, shown just how vulnerable the United States, with its traditions of an open society and freedom, even to buy a gun, can be for anyone committed to an act of violence. The destruction of the Albert Mura Federal Building in Oklahoma City sends the same chilling message that the bombers of New York City's World Trade Center did in 1993. No one is safe anywhere. What did I tell you? I'm right. I've studied these socialist pukes for years, and I'm right on the target. I'm the only one who has consistently and with absolute accuracy predicted every step that they're going to take. Listen to this. Anti-terrorism bill now on fast track. On Tuesday, the Omnibus Counterterrorism Act of 1995 was a proposal on a low track in Congress and the object of a lively debate as to whether it would violate some fundamental civil liberties, including the right to confront one's accuser. Now, after the Oklahoma City bombing, there are few sure legislative bets in Washington. Democrats and Republicans issue a blizzard of news releases Thursday calling for the bill's quick passage. The gutless wonders are at it again. American law enforcement agencies expanding overseas. FBI will open International Police Training Academy in Budapest next week. No new world order, no world government. Stick it in your ear. Many gangs of extremists active in the United States. FBI director says these terrorist groups pose a significant threat.
the demonization of patriots, lovers of liberty, those who would support, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States of America and of their states are being branded terrorists. He said, among other things, American militia groups are right-wing religious extremist groups, and often their members are angry at the federal government. A number of groups are well-armed with members who are trained in the use of explosives. What is that supposed to mean? It's supposed to mean the militia did it. It's supposed to mean the militia are the enemy. It's supposed to mean patriots are bad guys. What did I tell you? Clinton tightened security, saying, "We are working very hard to strengthen the ability of the United States to resist acts of terror." President Clinton ordered far more stringent security measures to be put in place at all federal buildings in Washington. In the last 2 days, bomb threats have been made in 7 other cities. More than that, folks, as you will find out. He called for the passage of the anti-terrorism bill. Representative Charles Schumer, another Marxist socialist puke, says the chief sponsor of Clinton's bill expects that this bill will move like lightning through Congress, and if it does, liberty in this country is history. It's history anyway if you don't wake up. Washington, U.S. Capitol Police took extra security precautions at the Capitol building. Dallas, a federal office building in Fort Worth, was reported to be evacuated Wednesday as a precaution following the devastating explosion in Oklahoma City. Other federal office buildings around the country were reportedly under heightened security. Casper, Wyoming, the federal courthouse in Casper was evacuated Wednesday after a bomb threat was called in, but no explosive device was found. The threat was one of many to federal facilities. Phoned-in bomb threats forced temporary evacuations of federal office buildings in several cities, including Boston, Miami, Santa Ana, California, Birmingham, Alabama, Wilmington, Delaware, Portland, Oregon, Boise, Idaho, and Carswell Air Force Base in Fort Worth, Texas. A bomb scare also forced the evacuation of Boston's City Hall. What did they do? Let all the inmates out of the nut house? Not on your life. This is all planned to terrorize the American people, to give up the Bill of Rights, to force us into a socialist, totalitarian, one-world government under the United Nations. It is coming. I have warned you about this. I predicted exactly these things would happen, and I am 100% right. It's the Reichstag all over again. In Germany, Hitler had opposition. The Nazi Party had opposition. They were not going to take control of Germany. Hitler sent his brown shirts out to create a crime wave. They did. The people called for relief and control and were willing to give up their freedom for protection and security. As one last measure to destroy his political opposition, Hitler burned the Reichstag, which is equivalent to the United States Congress. He burned the Reichstag. He then named his political enemies as the conspirators who burned it and destroyed his opposition in one night. Oklahoma City is America's Reichstag. In New York, police briefly evacuated the International Arrivals Terminal at New York's John F. Kennedy Airport Thursday to examine suspicious items of luggage. Vatican City. Vatican City. Even the Pope has to get in on this. Citing poison gas attacks on the Tokyo and Yokohama railway systems in Japan in the past month, it said terrorism for political and other motives was striking everywhere. There are no more limits to the ferocity, to the homicidal madness, to the will of extremist groups to perpetuate indiscriminate massacres. Nobody can feel safe anymore in any part of the world. That from the Vatican. Washington, Reuters, the deadly bombing in Oklahoma City of America's heartland stunned the nation.
We are a very open society with very little limitation on movement of people and goods. We should get used to the fact that terrorism is with us and hope that law enforcement authorities will prevent as much of it as possible. Clinton's proposed counterterrorism bill would let the United States deport illegal immigrants based for the first time on evidence known only to the government. The Omnibus Counterterrorism Act of 1995, now before the Senate Judiciary Committee, would also ban fundraising in the United States for groups the president deems dangerous and grant the FBI broader power to wiretap. FBI Director Louis Freeh told Congress that he needed new tools and resources to respond to a changing threat. He said state-sponsored guerrillas of previous decades were giving way to more decentralized groups which are harder to combat. Admiral William Studman, acting director of the Central Intelligence Agency, said in a recent congressional hearing that urban guerrillas were shifting from hostage-taking and hijacking to indiscriminate slaughter of innocent men, women, and children. He said the CIA had recorded 321 of what he called international terrorist incidents in the world in 1994. Nobody was concerned about it until it hit Oklahoma City. You could kill 5 million people in Cambodia and nobody cares. So don't fall for this crap. This is aimed at the Bill of Rights. And no patriot did it. No militia did it. We know who did it, and you know in your heart who did it, and you can see how it is being handled, and you can see what is coming. In fact, if I have to tell you what is coming, then you're blind as bat and just as stupid, and maybe you deserve it. I told you that they would first hit at Islamic fundamentalists, and then the investigation would swing and point directly at patriots and militia. The first arrested were three Middle Eastern men being held by the Immigration and Naturalization Service. They didn't do anything. Milwaukee. The United States is likely to see more violence of the kind that struck Oklahoma City, the acting head of the CIA said Thursday, and he should know, and I'm telling you, he's right. Washington. Republican congressional leaders said Thursday they were ready to work with President Clinton to pass tough anti-terrorist legislation in the wake of the Oklahoma City bombing. The Senate stands ready to work closely with the administration to pass the toughest and most effective anti-terrorist bill at the earliest possible time. Senate Majority Leader Bob Dole, Republican, Kansas, said, "You voted for him. I didn't." The vehicle used in the Oklahoma City bombing was a rented Ryder truck, CNN reported on Thursday. With bomb scares reported from New York to Texas to the Boston subway, jitters born of the Oklahoma City bomb blast rippled across the United States on Thursday, along with efforts to tighten security. For the first time since the 1991 Gulf War, roadblocks, extra security guards, metal detectors, and bomb-sniffing dogs appeared at federal buildings, airports, border crossings, and military bases nationwide. At least 15 federal buildings scattered across the country, including facilities in Houston, Boston, and Auburn, Washington, were briefly evacuated after receiving copycat bomb threats. A Brooklyn man was arrested after threatening to blow up a SunJet flight early Thursday morning. In Boston, a false bomb scare prompted police to evacuate the Massachusetts Bay Transportation Authority underground stations and trains for more than an hour. In New York, more police than usual were guarding government buildings and landmarks after Mayor Rudolph Giuliani put the city on heightened security. The busy International Arrivals building at New York's Kennedy Airport was evacuated briefly so the bomb squad could check unclaimed baggage. White House Chief of Staff Leon Panetta, named by President Clinton to coordinate the government response to the blast, said, "You cannot allow these kinds of unconscionable acts of terrorism to occur. We've issued directives out to something like 8,000 federal facilities across the country that now involve a heightened level of security. Here in Washington, as well as New York City, they're on maximum security conditions, and with regard to the other areas, they're all on heightened alert," he said. There's 50 states. Why did he say Washington and New York City? Police in Washington reported a surge of bomb threats. Late in the day, after most of its 5,000 employees went home, the Washington headquarters of the U.S. Department of Agriculture was evacuated as law enforcement officials and bomb-sniffing dogs searched the building after a bomb threat. Police cordoned off traffic on Independence Avenue, snarling rush hour traffic heading to the Virginia suburbs. Traffic reporters in Washington with the heaviest concentration of federal workers reported the flow to work appeared to be normal, suggesting that few were scared off. Parents continued to drop their children at daycare facilities. Public fears of further terror bombings in the United States are running high. What's running high is the media. They're running amok. They've lost their mind. They are nothing but propaganda avenues and puke-faced traitors for Marxist socialism, and they are in the process of destroying this nation. An ABC poll of 445, let me back up here. An ABC poll of 545 adults conducted by telephone Thursday said 78% expressed worry there will be more major terrorist attacks in the country. The poll, with a margin of error of 5% points, found majority support for extraordinary measures to suppress terrorism. 59% said they are willing to give up some of the liberties we have in this country in order to crack down on terrorism. Did I tell you or what? And no, I'm not embarrassed at all to say it. I told you so. I've been telling you for years. If you don't like it, turn off your radio, because I'm not going to stop. From London, is it the approaching millennium? The Oklahoma City bombing and gas attacks in Japan, blamed by some on religious cults, are stirring fears that as the year 2000 draws near, apocalypse cults will become more extreme. Guns, religious fundamentalists, constitutionists, patriots. Yokohama, a poison gas attack sent Japan into a panic for the third time Friday. You think this is a coincidence? When are you going to wake up? How much does it take to get something stirring between your ears? Are you going to be like the Jews and the Gypsies and the Poles and the Blacks and the Christians in Germany? Are you going to continue to say, oh, nothing's going on, the government wouldn't hurt us? Are you going to continue until you're rounded up and sent to some socialist labor camp because you don't fit in with their concept of how your mind is supposed to work in the New World Order? Is that what it's going to take before you wake up? Look around you. This is not the United States of America. Not at all. And that is not a constitutional Republican government in Washington, D.C., nor in most states of the several states. There's not much time left. Continue to recruit for your militias. Continue to prepare. Continue to arm yourselves. Continue to teach your children and your neighbors the truth about the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, and the principles and ideals upon which this country was based. Continue to call liars liars and traitors traitors. And don't stop and don't be afraid to do it. There's only one list, and we're already on it. And unless you are willing to die in slavery, then you'd better be willing to die for liberty. And remember, ladies and gentlemen, I've always told you this, and I will continue. Militias must be formed legally under the law. You must not ever allow any criminal activity. You cannot engage in racism of any type whatsoever. You can never fire the first shot, for whoever fires the first shot loses the war, not the battle, loses the war. They're in the process of attempting to propagandize the American people to believe that patriots bombed the federal building in Oklahoma City. No patriot would ever attack this nation. That's what the word patriot means. And remember, the nation is not Bill Clinton or Janet Reno. It is the Constitution for the United States of America and the first 10 amendments. Continue to form militias. Protect your leaders. Remember the order given by the commanding general of the Second Continental Army of the Republic and carry that order out. Counteract all of the propaganda and tell the people of America the truth. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Don't turn off your radio until exactly the top of the hour. And God bless you all.
Score and 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in the great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
That, ladies and gentlemen, is what the militia is all about. That is what patriotism is all about. And that is what the Constitution for the United States of America and the Bill of Rights protects. And don't you ever forget it.